So here's something about me.
Yeah.
I'm like super deaf.
Really?
Yeah. I've got to turn my TV like all the way up.
Yeah.
And put on subtitles.
Yeah, oh, so you do the same thing, right?
Oh, I can't understand anything that's going, like Game of Thrones, it might as well be in like Chinese.
Yeah, I start talking Chinese.
No! It's happening! It's happening in real life!
So in 2012, the ultimate boogeyman appeared.
Babadook?
In my gut, I feel like there's every probability this is a total wild goose chase boogeyman story. I don't believe that this is going to be a real thing anyone's going to face and have to deal with.
I really want it to be a thing. Back in 2012, some Japanese researchers developed a speech jamming gun.
The idea is you just aim it at whoever it is. And they mention in the context of like, let's say there's a debate and one party is going over their time. You can just shut them down. All of a sudden they're like,
I wonder if it's that effective.
There's two aspects to it. First of all, let's talk about the societal implications. If this was real, you could do crowd control. You could take dissidents and shut them up in the middle of their speech. This is the boogeyman story that I'm thinking of.
It's really insidious because it's something that really starts affecting how you think and speak.
Sure, sure. The problem is, when you see this in effect, there are characteristic ways people react that they can't get the words out. And so it'll be pretty clear that somebody's using a speech jamming device on you, right?
Oh yeah, because the whole thing is that you can hear it.
Right.
Everybody else will be able to hear it as well, right?
No, that's the brilliance of the speech jamming gun. See, there's two technologies. We'll talk about the speech jamming in a moment, but to me, the cooler part is the directionality of it. Focusing sound is problematic, right? Because whatever speaker you have, it's just gonna make a wave that goes farther and farther out. You can get more directionality instead of having one very loud speaker that goes out in a radial pattern. You can have an array of them all kind of facing forward. Think about like an array of LED lights.
Sure. Right?
If you have one LED light, it just goes everywhere. But if you have an array, they all tend to kind of focus. The problem is it's still fairly sloppy and everyone can hear around it. What you really want is the ability to focus sound like a laser on one individual person. So imagine, and in fact, I've tried to think of ways to use this in a magic routine and I haven't cooked up anything yet, but imagine an entire auditorium of people and I could have something pointed at one person who hears something that nobody else can hear. And in fact, it's subjectively, it's said that it sounds like it's coming from the object behind you, like in the old Scooby-Doo cartoons where they would do bad ventriloquism and make it look like it was coming out of a pot flower or something, right?
I think we need to do that in an episode, actually.
Yes, okay.
An entire Scooby-Doo themed
series. The Scooby-Doo series, that would be amazing.
Yes.
But the technology to be super laser precise in sound direction is audible sound from ultrasonic sounds. So here's the idea. Ultrasound tends to be more directional than regular sound, right? But still not directional enough, plus you can't hear it because it's ultrasound. But if you have two transmitters, each doing ultrasound, that come together, you can precisely time them in a way that their interference pattern generates audible sound that is only hearable to exactly one person.
Oh, fascinating.
Right?
So it is super precise.
Exactly.
Now, is that theoretical or is that something that they can do in practice?
I understand that this is in practice and has been played with and actually exists. And from what I've heard, there are even special megaphones being developed, or maybe they're already out there, that are used to, like for hostage negotiations. You want to be able to shout just at that one person and not have anyone else hear what you guys are talking about.
And then point it at the actual hostage and go, okay, we're bluffing. We want you to, on the count of three, kick him right in the balls.
So that's the one part, is the directionality. The other part is the speech jamming part, which I've experienced. Have you ever experienced this?
Brant told me I've experienced it. I don't really remember.
You have no memory.
It was like 3 years ago.
Go ahead, you talk into there and give it a try.
Okay, I have this doesn't, you, I don't.
Much like your sense of balance does not exist in a vacuum. It's not like you plant your 2 feet and now you're standing. Instead, your body is constantly reading the feedback. It's constantly adjusting. And likewise, even now as I'm talking, there's part of my brain that's coming up with the words, and the other part of my brain is monitoring my tone of voice, whether I'm too loud or too quiet. So you're very accustomed to feedback. In the case of a speech jammer, there's another signal that's overriding your primary signal. And I experienced this for the first time. I toured with Rascal Flatts, Brooks and Dunn, and Brad Paisley for an entire summer.
It was a weird summer.
It was a weird summer. And at one point they asked me to introduce one of the opening acts, and they handed me this microphone. It was the first time I'd ever experienced this phenomenon. And it was a giant, 30 30,000 seat arena stadium, and they're like, yeah, just introduce. And the first word came out, and about 200 milliseconds later, I hear my own voice, bigger than God, slapping me back in the face, and I was like, oh dear, like it's
so you just way. Have to shut it out.
Well, exactly, and so what I had to do was had to come up with something that I knew so well and rehearse it to mm-hmm. where I could disengage. I could, no matter what was happening, I could keep on delivering this speech. Ladies and gentlemen of the Astro Arena, please welcome back so-and-so. And it was very, very hard, but I feel like I've got it down.
Now, whenever you're using your own voice, I understand that the delay to auditory feedback so that you can monitor your own speech is 0.001 second. But whenever you are a victim of speech jamming, for an adult, it's usually around 200 milliseconds when it's the most effective. But as you get older, it can go up to like 400 milliseconds.
Because you're getting dumber.
Yes.
Slower.
Yes.
Okay.
And so it varies based on your age.
Now, the one thing I know for sure is that you have to have a loud enough signal that it overrides your own ability to hear yourself. Most of the people who have tried this at home have probably grabbed their earbuds, put it in, tried the app, and they're like, I don't get it. I'm able to talk just fine.
Right.
That is completely because your voice is loud enough that the outside influence is not overtaking it.
Right, and that's why a lot of hearing impaired people have trouble speaking. Now, this is also called delayed auditory feedback, and it was originally developed as something to treat stutterers.
Really?
Yeah, it would help them slow down, think about what they were saying, and start speaking normally. And what's odd is that non-stutterers kind of has the opposite effect.
Well, I was about to say, so stuttering, it might be implied, and we have no idea what we're talking about,
yeah.
But it might be implied
now
that
we're conjecturing.
Stuttering is, to some degree, a mismatch of the feedback you're getting from what you expect, and then that's what makes it difficult to stop and start again.
That's what they're saying. One other thing this makes me think of, how different milliseconds affect different ages, like 200 milliseconds for an adult, 400 for an older adult, etc. There's also the mosquito sound that only teenagers can hear. Have you heard about that?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, there are teenagers that set it as their ringtones, so that they're able to hear messages coming in and older people cannot. I was a little bit bummed to realize that
couldn't hear it.
There's a little bit.
I probably can't.
Actually,
either.
Hold on. Let me see. The app is called Mosquito Sounds, and it's got it's basically a soundboard that has different tones, and it says what years you should be able to hear them at.
Oh.
This is the part that upsets me.
Do you want to try this?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Don't press the one that says just summon all of the mosquitoes in the area.
It turns out I have the wrong app.
Yeah.
I am the mosquito god. I turn into swarm. 1 kilohertz is everyone. You should be able to hear this.
Okay.
Sorry, it's not on.
I was like,
there's a big button that says play.
I'm deaf. I can't hear it. Brian!
All right, here we go. I hear that.
Sure, yes.
Yep, okay. This is, if you're less than 100 years, you should be able to hear this.
Right? Definitely.
Easy.
Yep.
90 years.
Sure.
Yep.
Okay.
80 years. 70 years. This is happening faster than I'd like.
It is.
60 years. Okay. Like it's a video game.
I know, it's like getting to the challenge stage.
50 years. Okay, all right.
Okay.
45 years?
Yep.
Was that easy to hear?
Yeah, ish.
I can hear the beginning clip and the end clip of it.
Oh, yeah?
But in the middle, it's very
really?
Difficult to hear, yeah. Oh, yeah. My God, yeah, wow. Yeah. All right, well, this is under 40. We're now...
Okay. Okay, okay.
Yeah, wait, you can?
Yeah, I can hear that.
Wow. Under 30?
You didn't hit play, did you?
Did
you hit play?
I did.
Do it again. Nope.
Oh! 20. We'll at least put it in here. 18. So I guess I'm on track, yeah. Like around the 45-year mark is where it gets really hard for me.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So for the speech jammer, 300 milliseconds.
300?
You're halfway to old.
Okay.
You want it to be as loud as possible.
Okay.
So these are not noise canceling, but you'll notice that they should completely plug out the outside world.
Yep.
So I should be considerably quieter.
Okay.
And then what are you gonna read?
I am going to read an excerpt from Julius Caesar, Act 1, Scene 1, as read during the example show on Netflix.
No. When we first saw it, we're like, is he having a seizure? What's happening?
Yes.
Tributaries follow him to Rome to grace and captive bonds his chariot wheels. clocks. You stones. You worse than senseless things. Oh,
is this Shakespeare?
Hard hearts, you cruel men of Rome. No, you're not pumped.
It is Shakespeare.
All right, here, read it first, just straight.
Okay. Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? To grace and captive bonds his chariot wheels?
I want you to genuinely put yourself in the moment.
Okay.
Where it's like you're trying to sell it as an actor.
Okay.
Okay? You start and we'll see if you can figure out when I start.
Okay. Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? To grace and captive bonds, his chariot wields. You blocks, you stones, you worse than senseless things. Oh, you hard hearts. Okay, slow it down to like 200.
Speed it up to 200.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Knew you, not Pompey. Many a time have you climbed to walls and battlements, to tower and windows.
Because here's what you're doing, and this is a smart strategy. You are to get a footing. You're increasing your volume.
Oh, am I?
So that you're able, because you're shouting. So it's like I want you to try to. Okay. You know, don't let yourself hear your own voice and see if you can make it work.
Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? To grace in captive bonds his chariot wheels.
You blocks, you stones, you worse senseless things.
Oh, your hearts, you cruel men in Rome. Knew you not Pompey? many a time and oft have you climbed up to walls and battlements, to towers and windows, to chimney tops. Your infants in your...
Okay, all right. So that's 200 milliseconds. That's prime time. Let's see what happens if I speed it up to 100 milliseconds.
Okay.
Here, start from the beginning again.
Okay.
Here we go.
Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? To grace and captive bonds his chariot wheels? You blocks, you stones, you worse than senseless things. Oh, you hard hearts, you cruel men of Rome. Knew you not Pompey? Many a time and oft... Have you climbed up to walls and battlements, to towers and windows, yea, to chimney tops? Your infants in your arms.
All right, that's pretty good. Man, you could tell that you had a lot more control this time.
I was practicing more, and I was more like, I think I knew how to kind of fight it, and I think I was fighting. I shouldn't have been, but...
But you could definitely tell a difference between the performance before and after.
Yeah.
All right, let's try 300 milliseconds.
Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? To grace and captive bonds his chariot wheels? You blocks, you stones, you worse than senseless things.
Oh, you hard hearts.
You cruel men of Rome, you knew not Pompey? Many a time and oft have you climbed up to walls and battlements, to towers and windows, yea, to chimney tops.
is it worse? Is it harder at 300?
It was hard, yeah. Was that really 300?
Yeah, that's 300.
Okay.
Let's go to like 500. Let's try that.
Okay. Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? To grace and captive bonds his chariot wheels? You blocks, you stones, you worse than senseless things. Oh, you hard hearts, you cruel men of Rome. Knew you not Pompey? Many a time and oft.
So what was the sweet spot? Is 200 definitely the hardest?
I think that was the one that I had the most trouble with.
Yeah, you want here, just talk to me cool, like a normal person.
Okay, yeah. I don't know that that's gonna bother me much. Oh, wow, it's actually more difficult.
To speak extemporaneously?
Yeah. I thought it was supposed to be more difficult when you're just reading. But it's almost like it's canceling out the words as I'm thinking of them.
Yeah.
When I'm reading them, you know how you can go on on autopilot when you're just reading and you don't even know what you're reading?
Yeah.
Well, now I'm just kind of, it's like I can't think of the word.
It's amazing because I can see you getting frustrated and literally exhausted from the effort.
Yeah, because it's like I'm thinking of the word and then suddenly the word I just said nudges it out of the way. And it's like the words are fighting.
I'll bet subjectively this is a lot of what it's like to be a stutterer before you learn the tricks to get the words out.
That's got to be incredibly frustrating.
Okay, I wanted to test extemporaneous speech versus a script that you already know backwards and forwards. So if you don't mind, I'll give it a try.
I'm
gonna see, because I figure I'll do my fire eating talk, because I've done it a million times, right?
I've heard it a million times.
This is a well-rehearsed speech that I've given a lot of times. I'm gonna do my best to try to disengage from what I'm hearing and instead just be on autopilot.
Okay.
In fact, the trick I'm gonna use is I'm gonna be thinking about the motions that I do with my hands, and hopefully my conscious mind will be engaged with that thought instead.
Okay.
All right. The concept of resistance to fire. One is old as history. There goes that. All right, here we go.
Okay, try it again.
The concept of resistance to fire is one as old as history itself. As far back as the ancient Greek tragedy, references are made to holding a bar of red
a bar
hot.
Of red hot.
My God.
My God.
References are made to holding a bar, of, a red bar of red hot iron.
Iron,
which was used to prove innocence or sincerity.
Sincerity.
The first written account of a fire eater, however, occurs in 1607 when Sir Henry Wotton wrote of an English sailor. I'm doing the same trick where I'm shouting so I can get some kind of feedback. All right, here we go. The first written account of a fire eater, however, occurs in the 1600s when Sir Henry Wotton wrote of the English. So here's what happens. You want to extend a consonant long enough that it syncs with what you're hearing.
Yes.
Right? I gotta feel like this is what it's like to be afflicted with stuttering. By the 1800s, we come to a time that some people call the golden age of fire. I have said this speech.
A lot, yeah.
I've said this speech for 20 years. By the 1800s, we come to a time that some people call the golden age of fire eaters. A time when performers had names like Yamadeva, Chingling Fu, and Xavier Chabert the Fire King. It's when the focus of fire eating was shifted away from the tolerance of heat and flames,
but instead moved towards the artistry
with which they manipulated them. By the 1800s, the popularity of fire eating had taken a nosedive. In fact, Harry Houdini of all people. Okay, I'm calling it.
All right, that works.
That's all I'm gonna say. I'm gonna say I'm shut down political protests. I'm gonna stop fire eating magic shows.
Now you've given your weakness. Anyone, when you're performing a show, can use that on you.
I'll tell you what.
200 milliseconds.
Hold on.
That's the sweet spot.
I have to amend my original position because I was talking about how this probably wouldn't be the most effective tool for political dissidents, but on a petty level, if you could buy one of these for $200
or build
and
one,
you can mess up other performers at like talent show competition.
I want one for myself, for you.
I guess we gotta build one now, right?
I think so.
Okay, all right.
Project.
The concept of resistance to fire is one as old as history itself. As far back as the ancient... okay, don't, you can't manually do it.